Now Mike Naylor has the story of how a Shropshire rock band have this year found worldwide success. Radio Shropshire presents The Rise and Rise of Tapow.
Carol has always been a star, even before she was a star.
Here I am, I'm here. This is where I've always wanted to be, and I'm here. But you've got to stay there.
She walked into a room, and people used to look at her and say, she must be somebody. Without trying, she naturally lived up to that. You know, the girl's a star.
We don't think we're stars. I don't know when the time comes when you walk down the street thinking you're a star. We just feel dead normal.
All the stuff I read about myself in the newspapers, it's like it's happening to another person. It doesn't feel like it's me at all.
It was just one of those things where a live band comes through sometimes. We had everything going for us in way of marketing because we were on the road working. We'd just come off the top of Heart and Soul. The radio was going for it. For some reason or other, TV just slotted in the right place. And it's that sort of luck and momentum that gets you to number one rather than number two.
China In Your Hand will go down in pop history as the 600th British number one. The band toppled the Bee Gees to claim it, keeping out George Harrison and Rick Astley in November and December for 5 weeks. The record is also the bestseller this week in Switzerland and Denmark and is soaring upwards in most of the other pop charts in Europe.
We always thought of it as a great song. It was never recorded as a single. And everybody had been playing around with it, wanting it to be a single. And they made us edit it, which we did. But until Ronnie turned around and said, you know, this doesn't work, the edit, let me go and re-record it. It was never a single till that point. Mind you, you know, 3 days and £3,500. It's good money well spent.
I'll say. Well, Chris Cook is the manager of Tapow. Four of the six members are based here in Shropshire. From Shrewsbury, lead vocalist Carol Decker.
I think maybe there is a call for, like, a rock-pop band to elbow its way through all the dance music. I'm not saying anything wrong with dance music, but there's a lot of it at the moment, isn't there? Rick Astley, Curiosity, real slick dance stuff. And I think people were probably ready for something a bit more raw. But, I mean, it's easy to theorise. I think it's probably luck, Mike, more than anything. You know, it's our turn to be lucky.
Also from the county town, rhythm guitarist Ronnie Rogers.
We both knew or thought that it was going to happen, but when it happens, it's unbelievable. It's bang, you just work to death. You don't get a day to yourself or anything. So that's come as a shock, the actual amount of work that is involved. But you get a glow from it and you walk a bit taller.
Paul Jackson from Hadley plays bass.
Nothing's really changed that much. It's not all glamour. The only real glamour is when you go on stage for 40 minutes or whatever. Your life's pretty much the same, but nothing's really glamorous. We don't have flash cars and swimming pools in our back gardens yet or anything.
And from Oaken Gates, Michael Chetwood on keyboards.
I think everybody thinks that we're rich and famous now, and we're not yet. It's a long way to go, really. I mean, I enjoy it, and this is what I've been working for a long, long time. I mean, the success has happened quickly, but a lot of it's luck, a lot of it's talent, a lot of it's good singing as well.
The album Bridge of Spies also went to number one. And we can reveal that in Britain and America, the sales have now reached a staggering 1 million. So how much of this success is due to the leadership of Carol Decker?
95%, I would have thought, and quite rightly so. it's just normal for a singer to have all the attention, and because Carol's the only girl in a male band, if you like, that's an extra spur for everybody to want to interview her. So we just let her get on with it.
That's fine by me, actually, because it means I can spend more time in bed in the mornings because I don't have to do any interviews and things. No, I don't mind at all. She's glamorous. She's got a personality to do it. She heads the band very well. She represents us well. Our main job's actually the music. That's what I'm interested in, and that's what I do. So the limelight aspect isn't that worrying for me.
The opening song into Power's live act, and this year the band has been pounding the road in Europe and America for an incredible 30 weeks. Their first headline tour came after supporting Nick Kershaw and Bryan Adams. We checked them out in Leeds.
Absolutely brilliant. The girl was superb, her voice was superb. I just said to my wife, you know, Annie Lennox, eat your heart out. For me, she's much better. We've seen Eurythmics a few months ago and she's much better.
They were brilliant. Yeah, really good.
They were really good live.
She's a good singer.
Funky music.
Songs were great, the band were good, but for me, she steals the show, the girl, you know, and sexy with it. She looks good, she looks the part.
Power have been playing British venues like the Wembley Arena and the NEC at Birmingham. Yet this time last Christmas, you could get to see them here in Shrewsbury at the Penguin.
It only took me one Wembley to find my feet, but when I did my first Wembley, I did the first four songs with a very dry mouth and in a trance, because I'd never walked out in front of that many thousands of people before in an arena situation. You know, they're so far away from you that it's such a cold room and you've got all that in front of you. But we are ourselves now a known commodity, so we don't go out onto that stage to nothing. Even if some gigs have been more tepid than others, they've still been good.
What we've discovered, the best thing to do is just to keep at them, you know what I mean? It's like, if they're up for it from the start, then it's easy on everybody, but if they're not, if they don't clap when you want them to clap, don't not do it, just keep on at them, you know what I mean? Not audience participation, but remember all your stage moves and things like that, and carry them out, whether they're in the bar or whether they're watching you and clapping or anything, just do the job.
Glasgow, Bournemouth, they screamed so loudly when I walked on stage, I couldn't believe it was for us, really. The really big arenas, they take quite a bit of warming up. Like, by the end of the week at Wembley, we were having such a good time. The Friday night was so much better than the Monday, and at the NEC, the second night was so much better than the first. And you kind of find your feet, gain your confidence, and the audience sense that.
It was pretty exciting, nerve-wracking as well. It's a great buzz though, because it went down so well.
I find it easier playing gigs like that than gigs with a few people, and there's less sort of pressure. So I hope we do those in future, and we won't have to go back to little pub gigs ever again.
Throughout the year, Shropshire-based Jenny Brooke has been the band's tour manager.
They've slowed down on stage, they've choreographed their movements even, they've paid attention to their dress and the way they present themselves, which, although it all may look casual, it's, you know, a lot of thought's gone into it. And a band needs that, they need to have some kind of direction and to power, because they're all so different, they didn't really know what they wanted. So to have someone put in some ideas, and we actually did have a choreographer come over from Los Angeles, and he's a ballet teacher, in fact, and he taught them just little things like Ron and Paul going to the microphones to sing and then stepping back a step and then going forward again, just little touches which maybe are obvious to someone who's watched musicians, but you wouldn't think of doing if you're actually on stage, you know, and it took them a while to get used to it, but it's worked very well.
What we've done, we've made a conscious effort not to make the image too strong, if you see what I mean, like a Zig Sputnik thing or anything like that. So we've actually consciously sat down and thought of an image. Although it's not strong, we can live it from day to day, so it's no, we don't have to get dressed up in the morning because we are what we are, if you see what I mean.
Alongside this honesty, the nation's rock critics have had their pens poised, and it seems they've been ready to pounce onto POW.
The reaction's been mixed, you know, we've had good reviews and bad reviews, I think every band has that. We noted when we were on the Nick Kershaw tour and we were this fresh, young band without any success, we never got a bad review, and now we're successful. They slag you rotten because they hate you when you've made it. They absolutely hate you, and I don't know why. It's a tried and tested thing, but all the people who are writing nice things about it in Sounds and Enemy and stuff like that, now it's like to POW, you know, they've sold out because they're successful, which is complete poppycock. So the reaction has varied from different people, you know. I mean, the most important thing is what the public think. When we go out on stage, we get the most phenomenal response from the audience now. So they're the people that count, not the journalists, and they're the people who buy your records, aren't they? Oh, and they've finally done it to me in number one. They put a picture of me and Fergie side by side, going, spot the difference. It says, has anybody noticed a similarity between Carole Decker and Fergie? Back end of a bus spotter from Gwent. Before To POW was conceived 2 years ago, Carol, Ronnie, Michael and Paul had been slogging away on the local music scene for a number of years, playing in no less than 12 previous groups. Many of them were founded by or through the Salop Music Centre in Shrewsbury. Former manager Julian Westbury Ward.
Michael and I went to school together at Wellington Grammar School, but I think it's called Arkle Wood School now. We got a band together when we were both 15. We didn't have a singer, so it was an instrumental band. And I remember the first gig we ever played was a round table gig. It was a dance at the Palace Ballroom in Albrighton. It must have been 69. We then played in various different bands together. We were in a band called Livingstone, which was quite well known in Shropshire. Andy, who's the proprietor of Salop Music Centre, he was also in Livingstone. And Bernard, his partner, he was in Livingstone. And we played as Livingstone for about 2 years. And then Michael and I had a band which we called the Charlie Mallet Band because our friend Charlie Mallet was the bass player. And then we joined the Band of Joy, which was a band based on Birmingham, which originally Robert Plant had been a member of. And it was reformed some years after he left to form Led Zeppelin.
From the Band of Joy, Michael Chetwood, who's a qualified architect, moved on to the Gasmen. And that's a band, by the way, who were based in Telford. And then on to the Birmingham heavy metal outfit, The Alliance. Meanwhile, Carol Decker was leaving Wellington High School. Jenny Brooke again.
Carol and I met about 8 years ago and we were at art school together. And I think she wanted to be a fashion designer or something like that. She was always into drawing glamorous women with fingernails and nice clothes on. I remember the head of the art school said that she was obsessed with sex and fingernails. But art wasn't in it, I don't think. You know, we spent more time skiving.
Carol's various jobs in the area included waitressing, working behind a bar, a lifeguard in Shrewsbury swimming baths, and as a model maker.
I knew her first when she used to work for the museum in Iron Bridge. I used to be the van driver and I used to take her wages. She came along with a friend just to watch one day when we were rehearsing with a band called Skidmarks. She was singing along and I said, why don't you get up and sing? And I discovered she could sing. She sounded like Carol Decker, basically, but there were other people who had ideas of people she did sound like, but she tried not to sound like anybody. I think she tried to develop her own vocal style, and so when the opportunity came to form a band, which was probably 3 months later, and I was looking around for a singer. She came up, and that was it.
The Lasers were born in December 1979, and at the same time, Nigel Hudson was working as a Shropshire club entertainer.
When I listened to the cassette, the demo that they did at Red Bull Studios in Market Drayton, it was very obvious that Lasers were, you know, I mean, talented in all sorts of ways, musically, lyrically. And we were coming out of the two-tone Coventry business, this sort of ska reggae. The music had such a lot of drive and a lot of bounce. You could feel it, you could feel movement, you could feel that they were enjoying themselves. And because of that, I just decided that, seeing as they wanted me to manage them, I'd have a go at it. Found loads of photographs, which I wouldn't like to publish, so well, I wouldn't mind, but Carol wouldn't thank me for it. She's got natural auburn hair. It looked a bit like a red-haired Sandy Shaw cut, I suppose, or Murray Mature. The bass player, Alan Rowe, used to wear this sort of trilby hat, and Julian, the guitarist, used to wear braces and jeans, and no shoes, I remember, no shoes or socks at that time. And Malcolm Ragg, the drummer, used to be then, I don't know if he still is, a truck driver. In fact, Malcolm used to wear shorts, and they used to go out with a lot of drive, a lot of bounce, and go out and, in Carol's terms, not mine, go out and grab them by the balls.
We certainly did get attention because of Carol, there's no doubt about that. There were always jokes and things about she had the best bum in the business and all this sort of thing, but I think she expected that because she was up front, and we had a female vocalist who was very good at projecting her personality.
The Lasers played gigs like the Ironmaster at Telford and Rotters Club in Hereford, but the lack of suitable venues in Shropshire forced them further afield.
I thought, well, Birmingham's the nearest place, so I started getting them at places like the Barrel Organ, where they weren't taking any money at all. It was the door take. I remember going to the landlord there and saying, because it was a rock venue, I remember going to the landlord and saying, I've got this brilliant band, Carol Decker and Lasers. You've got to have them, and can we talk money? And he said to me, yeah, well, how much were you thinking of giving me? And I said to him, look, I'll tell you what, we'll do Take of the Door. And he said, OK, you can have the Take of the Door. It's £1 for anybody to get in. I'll only allow them to play at the Barrel Organ if you bring 2 coach loads of fans with you. They got a great deal of reaction, so much so that they were rebooked in places, and we were able, you know, to raise the money up to £30 sometimes.
But poor appearance money didn't put off a Birmingham-based record company. Big Bear Records signed the Lasers in a 3-year deal in May 1980, and the band had 2 songs on a compilation LP of Midlands-based bands called Brumbeat.
Well, they actually got paid £36 for doing the album, which I think is probably history in the making. I don't know how many bands actually get paid these days for recording. But they went into the Barrel Organ and they recorded a whole set. And then afterwards, the band and the record company decided which 2 tracks to use on the album, the compilation. They then went into a studio called Zella in Birmingham to overdub some vocals and some guitar.
Yeah.
That's Carol Decker and the Lasers, as featured on the Brumbeat album. A television appearance followed in March 1981 on the Midlands-based BBC One show Look Here, hosted by Toya Wilcox. Duran Duran also featured in that series before they became famous. And on the same show as the Lasers, The Selector.
We knew we were going to be on, but we didn't know when the recording date was. And when the date for going to do the session came up, Carol was in Tenerife. So we had to try and get hold of her and get her back halfway through her holiday. Nigel, our manager, he managed to get her back. And she actually sang on stage in the shorts that she was wearing in Tenerife. Which we didn't all agree with that.
I said, look, I know you're only wearing jeans and T-shirts on stage as stage clothes, although Carol used to dress up very well. I said, we'll be a bit flash. We'll take some stage clothes on a hanger under a plastic bag so you look like a professional band. And so they did. The next thing, Selector turned up with them gold monogrammed leather suit bags and really put us to shame. I remember hanging my head down for that one.
At this point, the Lasers parted from Big Bear Records.
You think, right, this is it. We're nearly famous. But actually what happened was that Big Bear didn't have a great deal of money and we never actually released a single, which is what we were hoping to do, because they didn't have the money to put it together properly. We didn't seem to be going anywhere with them, so we thought we'd try and look around for something else. So we let the options slip, and so did they. But we thought we were much better than anybody else, because you do. We played a lot of barbecues in the middle of Wales in front of 1,000 very inebriated people. That was a peculiar thing to do sometimes, because they weren't in the least bit interested in the music. And we just played to nobody, although there was 1,000 people in front of us. If you're playing a pub in Birmingham, you're lucky if you go away with £10. Whereas if you're playing a gig in Wales, you get, say, 70, 80, 90. It's probably gone up since then.
Later on, we managed to get them in to places like universities, Warwick University, and they were support band, but they were on 100 quid. Wolverhampton Polytechnic, same, 100 quid. They were now playing to, you know, hundreds of people as opposed to dozens of people in a pub. But when you say Warwick University for 100 quid, it sounds great, doesn't it? Until you take into account that you've got to get there. Julian had an old Dormobile van that they used to jump in. I mean, it sounds so cliche now, doesn't it? Every rock band in the world has been up and down the motorway in a Dormobile van, but it actually happened.
We were playing a teacher's training college in Canterbury, and we set off midday, and it took us 7 hours to get there. Malcolm the drummer wasn't very well, so he was on medication, asleep on top of the gear in the back of the van, and everything, we thought it was going to be a really bad gig. And when we got there, we went down exceptionally well, and we really enjoyed the night, and because it was a proper students' union job, we got decent money for it, which I think was £120. And then we drove back after finishing, and I got back to Shrewsbury at 7:30 in the morning and went straight to work the next day without having any breakfast or anything.
At certain venues, there was a place, I think it was called The Star at Shifnal, and you'd try and get the band in a place like that, and you had to take your own support band as well. So, I mean, Lasers were taking with them local bands then with names like The Naked Housewives. If they're listening, they'll know what I mean. And another band called The Fear of Flying, and also a band called The Cats, which Ronnie used to be the band leader for that band, Ronnie Rogers.
Ronnie's musical career in Shrewsbury followed a similar path.
Well, Ron started his musical career, sort of thing, in a band called Dan Duran. Not Duran Duran, but Dan Duran, as in Dan Duran. Yeah. They thought it would sound really good. They were just a group of friends. I don't think they were very good because they were sort of about 15 or 16.
He moved on to a group called Dixie Chicken, and then managed a group called The Cats, and then later joined them. They were founded by the Traherne brothers, Danny and Twig.
Ron's ambition was always to be famous. That was it, always. He said that from the start. That's all he wanted to do, was be famous. The money never interested him much. We've actually seen it grow, his talent, from sort of writing songs which were 12-bar riffs and that sort of thing, into what he's writing and producing now. He used to get a 4-track TX studio, wasn't it? And Ron would always be the one who actually produced us, even then.
See you.
That's a track from an early demo cassette by Cats, featuring Ronnie Rogers on vocals. And they used to play places such as the Drum and Monkey near Minsterley.
Well, we all used to say, well, we'll go and have a drink somewhere else first, and then wait for the people to come in, the crowds.
Mm.
So we'd go for a drink at 9 o'clock, come back at 11, we'd do on stage at half past 11, and there'd still be the same people there.
That's right.
My wife, Ron's girlfriend, your girlfriends, and that would be it.
We've had four people at the most.
We thought we'd do well, but we like to laugh more than doing well, I think. We was always known as a bunch. There was the four of us, and for 2 years or so, I mean, not only did we play together, we went everywhere together. I mean, Ron was my best man. He shared a flat with Danny. You know, it was all very close. And then Ron moved on to better things. He could see it wasn't going to work. It was great fun, but he could see that it wasn't going to be anything big or anything. We were just going over and over the same venues, the same thing, you know, and it was starting to get a little bit boring.
And the Cats were hilarious.
Yeah, we used to have a good laugh, but the actual...
You were like the Baron Knights, just play tricks on each other on stage.
Right. It was good fun, I must admit. But listening back to the demos we did, I can understand why nobody took us up, I think.
But at the time, you believe in it. That's how you keep yourself going, is that at the time you believe in it. And you might look back later and laugh and cringe with embarrassment that you even sent those tapes out, but you believed in it and it kept you going.
But if you don't believe in it when you do it, then you might as well stop.
Carol met Ron, and it was love at first sight. So Ron was always there when we were playing, and we were always there when the Cats were playing. We'd been going together with the Lasers for about 2 years. I was finding it more and more difficult to come up with decent material. And so I suggested that we use some of Ron's songs, because he was writing very commercial songs at the time, which they were using with the Cats. So the next thing was we got Ron in the band, because he's also a good showman, which we recognised from seeing the Cats. So he was in the band, and we thought that we'd change the name as well and go and be a completely different band, although the three of us were still the same people. And so that's what we did, and we became Talking America, about which there is a story, because Nigel, our manager, was always trying to get us to stop being parochial. And he'd say, look, I'm Talking America now, and that's where we got the name from.
You could certainly count on Talking America persevering. They changed their lineup twice in the autumn and winter of 1982, and the following spring they had a recording session at EMI Studios in London.
This was about the time when Ron and Carol realised that they were probably the hotter property in the band, that their songwriting was more important than the band itself, because playing local gigs wasn't doing any good. I remember when we went to EMI Studios, Carol said, everybody's got to get dressed up and look really smart and trendy, because we're going to London to see the proper recording people of EMI. Ron and Carol went and they looked absolutely marvellous, like they always do, and the rest of us looked like scruffy people from Shrewsbury. So I think that also made Carol realise that we weren't quite as good at looking good as we should have been. I think what happened was that Carol and Ron decided that they would be better off working as a duo, trying to get themselves a publishing and recording contract without a band, because they had their own little studio at home and they could write their own songs without bothering to play them with a band, and that they'd be much better off that way, and they could travel around visiting people without having to drag three or four other people with them. So we just had a meeting and it was all amicable. I mean, we realised that that's what they wanted to do.
I was working for British Telecom, and we wrote a song called Taking Time Out, and we were sending all the cassettes away, and the guy came back to us, and he wanted to enter it for the Eurovision Song Contest.
But anyway, you don't sniff for anything.
New songs found their way to a certain Chris Cook in London.
I had a tape with four songs on. Taking Time Out was the one that I really liked. I thought it was a great song. I thought it was a very good pop song. And I went to Ronnie and Carol and said, look, I don't know sort of what kind of band you are, but I think this is good for Eurovision. I want to put it in for Eurovision, which we did. And they came back to me and said, well, look, you know, why don't you come and see us playing live, because we're doing the marquee with Terraplane. And my immediate reaction was that they were going to die a death playing to the wrong audience. So I went along to see them, and they didn't. Carol did her usual and took the audience by storm. I didn't like the band at all. I didn't think the band worked at all. But she carried the whole thing. They even got an encore in front of somebody else's audience in the marquee. And I was very impressed. We went from there, really.
At this time, Chris became the manager of Talking America, and he secured a publishing deal for Ronnie and Carol with MCA. That meant that other people could record their songs.
That gave us a little bit of income, because they gave us a publishing advance.
And then I chose to pack in my job.
We'd reached a point then where we realised we were, obviously, I mean, a lot of people, if they live in London, they're on the doorstep of all these people, they may even get into the session circuit. Being in Shrewsbury, we're too far away to be session musicians. We're also not good enough to be session musicians, I hasten to add.
So then the kids are.
So we had to make inroads into the London management scene. And once we started to do that, like when Chris picked up on us and MCA picked up on us, we began to realise that it was feasible to do it full time. So we took the risk.
To keep his hand in playing live, Ronnie adopted the fun name and fun band Ronnie Goes to Hollinswood, which played around Shropshire, adopting mostly cover versions. This gave Ronnie the chance to assess other musicians' capabilities in the county, with a view to perhaps them joining Talking America or a possible new band.
What I felt in seeing them live, hearing the tape, was that what was on tape wasn't where they were thinking. So we set about trying to pull the two together, is having 100% commitment. Instead of chasing trends or what A&R men wanted, was to find out what the band really felt their music was about and develop it from there. So to go back and start again, and which initiated a toughening up process on the material, because really they were a lot tougher than the songs that were coming out. They were very poppy, because they have good melodies and she's got great lyrics. And they were just coming across in a weedy sort of way. Because the strengths of Carol as a live performer, at the same time we started to construct a new band, because the rhythm section wasn't happening in the previous band. So we started from scratch.
Tad Wiskowski was recruited for lead guitar, and Paul Jackson from the local Telford band Dark on bass.
He came to Ronnie and Carol's house to demo using Carol's, Carol and Ronnie's recording equipment, and Ronnie produced it, and he thought he was really good. And I'd been on at them to change the bass player, because at that point I didn't think the rhythm section worked. And they said, well, we'd try him out, and we came up, and I thought he was really good.
I managed to send the tapes around, and the one that landed on the siren desk, they rang back and said one of the songs, Heart and Soul, would be good if the Nolans did it. That was their first comment.
Yeah.
Right, and then they rang back again and said, no, we've had another listen.
Yeah,
and
it doesn't sound too bad.
And then they rang again, I think, and they'd had to listen to all the tracks, and they said, yeah, we'd like to see them.
You know, they said, we want to see the band live, and Chris said, well, they're not working live at the moment because they're busy writing. He said, if you want to see them, put them into a rehearsal studio. And we went into Gnomis, which is a lovely big complex. It's got stages in it and that. And Chris basically bamboozled them into paying for that studio time. They paid all our expenses and everything. So you more or less say, well, you want to see us, you damn well pay for it, because we're good. And I'd gone through the Butterflies and the Tummy before doing several showcases. And I was excited, but we really thought, if you don't like us, you're stupid. So I did put on a bit of a show for them. And the head of our company, Dave Betteridge, and our A&R man, Simon Hicks, said, they walked in and they just thought, wow, you know, great band, really energetic.
The restructuring of the band was complete, and so too was the recording contract. Saren gave them a 5-year deal. And they named the band after a Klingon in Star Trek, and T'Pau travelled to Wisconsin in America to record that first album, which was produced by Roy Thomas Baker, who'd previously worked with The Cars and Queen.
We didn't really know what to expect when we went there, and different producers worked in different ways. So we could have gone in and had it come out like a Trevor Horn type thing, which he just rips the songs apart and turns them upside down and...
Or the producer is
and
the
stamps
artist,
his thing so much on them that, you know, you can just tell him out a mile sort of thing. But Roy sort of just let us get on with whatever we wanted to do.
Basically...
Very subtle, is
it? The structure of the songs hardly changed at all. Do all the playing, for better or for worse, at home, and work all the parts out, and then the band bring their skill into play, interpreting the song. So he didn't actually change much. What he concentrated on was good sounds.
It's hard to put your finger on exactly what he does. It's sort of it's a bit of psychology involved.
He
and
works
things
in
like
mysterious
that.
Ways, Mr. Baker.
Yes, he does.
He cons you into things. You don't realise you've done it until later.
That's right.
As far as he's concerned, he looks upon us very much as his current protégés.
The one on the album that really sticks out to me is Valentine. We're dead pleased with it because it was the first real song we'd written, what we considered to be real, and to actually go through all the recordings and re-recordings of that and actually finally get it onto vinyl was quite a, you know, it's quite a nice moment, really. That one's the oldest one on the album. It's, I think it's 5 years. 5 years. And that was, we actually got interest on that song when we were with the Lasers. So that's how long ago it was. And, but the trouble was, they said, we love the song, let's have some more like it. And we didn't have any more like it. And not that we would have done it anyway. But that was the reason we didn't get signed up on it, because we only had that one song. And then when we did Art and Soul, we had the same again. They said, we like Art and Soul, let's have some more like that. So we were getting all these good songs together one at a time, but nobody had the sense to put them together on an album, you know, and market it properly, which Siren did, fortunately.
I can't.
That's De Pauw's new single, Valentine, officially out in January, and being tipped by many people to go to the top spot on Valentine's Day. I hope the band are having a well-earned Christmas holiday now. They'll be writing new material in January. They'll be going out on the road in this country in February and March, and then abroad in April and May. And they'll be going to France to record that new LP around June time. It's been a staggering year for De Pauw from Shropshire.
It's a rat race, it really is. You meet some very nice people, and we're lucky in that we have a nice crowd of people working with us, like our agent and our promoter, and Chris, our manager, has chosen the people that he likes, and because he's a good guy, then the people he likes are nice, good, down-to-earth people, but you meet some real assholes, you really do.
I don't know how it has changed me in business areas. Obviously, I've had to kind of prick my ears up and keep my brain sharp over different kinds of things. We meet, I'm glad to say, 90% of the time, really nice people. The 10% that we do meet that are complete creeps, I've learned to be very short with. But I'm protecting myself, you know. I'm just protecting myself. But all of my close friends and my family, they're the only people I care about. And going back to the thing again about, you know, our relationship, mine and Ronnie's relationship, we all know what the truth is. The people who really know me know what I'm like. So who cares about the rest of them, really?
Anybody that's successful, people have to knock them. It's just a British way of going on. But there may be people in the Shropshire area that despise the fact that Carol or De Pauw are stars now. And all I can tell those people is the cream floats to the top. We're on about 7 years experience on the road, feeling the pinch, not having any money, starving, being in debt to a certain extent, trying to get money from wherever they can get, and that's what it was like. They were bloody hard up, and now they won't have to worry about things, and that's what pleases me.
It takes a long time for your royalties to come through, especially if you make your initial success in America. Their system's a lot more their accounting system and stuff is a lot more sluggish than ours, I've been told. I can assure everybody at the moment, the whole band is on a very modest retainer, and we're still driving a beat-up Ford Cortina estate with a coat hanger in the aerial socket. So there, fame hasn't changed me at all. And I'm still covered in dog hairs whenever I go out. So I honestly don't know. Obviously, I'm looking forward after, you know, 7 years of having hand-to-mouth jobs like waitressing and bar work, all sort of supplementing my career. I'm looking forward to having some real money. But I don't honestly know how much yet.
They, in De Pauw, are going to stay around because they're what's known as a pension band. They've done their homework, they've had their experiences, they've had their knocks, and providing they can handle success, which I'm sure they can, they're going to be around for a long time. You're talking big names like David Bowie, Paul McCartney, those sort of bands, and they're going to be around for a long time. And Ronnie is a superb producer. I mean, when he gets 50 and he doesn't want to go on the stage anymore, although that's very doubtful, he'll be producing albums for new bands.
Obviously, you try not to get too high and mighty and think, obviously, you know, our music is so wonderful. Everybody's crazy about us at the moment, and it's wonderful, but we're trying to keep a perspective on it, and we want to be an album-selling band as opposed to like a pop band, if you know what I mean. That's what we're aiming for.
Dave Chumbley is De Pauw's agent.
The band are very successful in the UK. However, outside of the UK, I mean, in America they do very well, but it's a question of degrees, really. Bryan Adams, for instance, has spent a lot of time touring and sold a lot of records. And De Pauw, this is sort of a very successful first step. It's the next 25 which are going to determine whether the dues have been paid and they're going to be very successful. I hope so. I believe so. But whether that's actually going to come true is another matter.
We sort of got a sketch plan up until the summer, and it's non-stop. So, you know, there's the album, then there's a German tour, and then back to America, and it's going to be hard work, but good fun, and hopefully the rise and rise and rise of De Pauw through 88.
Rise and Rise of Tapau was written and produced by Mike Naylor.